Welcome to Things We've Said Today, our weekly podcast radio show about all things to do with the Beatles. I'm Allan Cozen. I'm joined by my co-hosts, Steve Marinucci, who you know from as the Beatles Examiner and many other kinds of examiners on the internet, Al Sussman, a contributor and actually these days executive editor of Beatle Fan, our other regular co-host Ken Michaels is away this week. We do have a guest, Candy Leonard, the author of Beatleness, which will soon be coming out in its paperback edition. One of the more interesting books to turn up in the past year, full of books celebrating the Beatles' 50th anniversary. And we're going to be talking about a 50th anniversary tonight, which is the anniversary of Rubber Soul. Not that any of them are less important particularly than any of the others, but certainly a highlight in the Beatles catalog, a turning point in a lot of ways. A lot of people feel the first, you know, step towards really sort of maturity as composers and recording artists. And so we're going to be all talking about that. And it's a specialty of Candy's. So why don't we start with you and tell us what draws you so strongly to Rubber Soul?
Well, I can still remember the first time I heard it. When I was interviewing fans for Beatleness, as you said in your introduction, that was the record that really where you saw and heard them evolving kind of before your very eyes. I mean, we saw it a little bit with Help, and all along, every time we saw them, they looked a little, different, whatever. But Rubber Soul was absolutely it was recognized by the end users, as we call the fans today, using lingo from today. What was the experience of the end, the user experience, right? So they experienced it as something radically different, and even not only the music, but everything about it, the cover, their appearance was different. They were one fan, cool. That was the word. I mean, talking about Rubber Soul or anything else Beatle, the two words that I heard the most were cool and joy. And of course, both those words were applied to Rubber Soul, absolutely. But the cover of how cool they looked, and like everything with the Beatles, their mind was open, their ears were open to music, to the language that they were using, and it brought me along. I didn't necessarily have to be thinking about girl-boy relationships in this way yet, but there it was, and it was so compelling. I mean, the music was always so compelling, and they loved it. They loved it. And critics loved it, too. In fact, that was where I think it was Newsweek that 2 years before had dismissed them, called them bards of pop and praised it to the hilt. And so it was really their cultural authority, really, with fans, with critics, with the establishment, if you will, really changed with Rubber Soul.
Mm-hmm. So, Al, what do you remember of it coming out?
Well, I was, I was such a fan at that point that I, was waiting with bated breath for every new Beatles release. And just, a few weeks earlier, we had gotten this incredible double A-sided single, We Can Work It Out, a Day Tripper. So we knew that there was a new album coming out, and it was almost, not quite how it was in the weeks before Sgt. Pepper came out, but certainly there was a lot of anticipation. And I can recall as if it was yesterday, going into a record store in Hackensack, New Jersey, and seeing it, and especially since this was to show you how incredibly big the Beatles were at that moment in time. The word Beatles is not on the front cover of that album. Just that kind of slightly distorted Robert Freeman, right, picture mm-hmm. of the Beatles with, again, the slightly what I guess we would later term as psychedelicized title up in the corner, up in the left-hand corner.
And but the title just, is like the shape of a soul, right? The sole of a shoe.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, exactly. And just seeing that, I mean, that first image is kind of locked into my memory. And
it's a very striking image. Yeah, striking.
Yeah.
Very, very much so. Very much so. And, you know, and especially as Candy said, you know, you kind of look at the album cover and, you know, all during the year, people had been looking at pictures of them and their hair was a little longer and there was a certain glint in their eyes, well, at least two of them, that we didn't quite know about yet. Mm-hmm. But it was very 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 interesting to see
they
that.
Seemed mm-hmm. they seemed more grown up in that picture.
Yes.
In other words, they weren't you know, the hair was a little shaggier. They looked like they mm-hmm. were wearing regular clothes. It didn't have that posed. I mean, it was obviously posed, but it looked more. It just they looked more grown up. They looked less managed. Somehow,
it wasn't
less
a four. It wasn't a Four Jolly Mop Tops picture.
Right.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And the four of them, and they're kind of slightly looking down. In fact, one fan described it as they looked menacing, like they were looking down on a victim.
Mm-hmm. Weird. So
you know, they look very powerful. You know, they look very big and important. You know, which they were at that time. I mean, they were really, I wouldn't say at the top of the world. Yeah, well, yeah, they were kind of.
They were absolutely.
You think about the arc of, you know, there are many ways you can sort of define that arc, and certainly mm-hmm. late '65 was, you know, way, you know, they were very much ascending still. You know,
yes.
and really up there and. You know, they had just won the MBE, not won, whatever, they'd just been awarded. It's a weird way of describing it. Yeah, they had just been awarded the MBE. They, you know, had been at the Shea concert, had been a few months before. It was the end of mm-hmm. '65. And it was, they're on top of the world. They were four princes, you know, and anything that they said or did, the world paid attention. And this album, you know, no exception.
I love the moodiness on that cover. It's just Candy used the word cool. I don't know if cool is the exact word I would use, but it was a welcome change from all the, you know, the mop top, like you said, the mm-hmm. mop tops stuff. They were getting away from that and they were letting people know that things were definitely different now. You know, they weren't what we originally knew them as. They were evolving, and that was one of the things that was really good. It's kind of scary if you had been able to predict the future and see what was coming up after with Revolver. You know, that would have I think freaked a lot of people out.
But you did when it came out,
right? But I think if people had mm-hmm. known that was going to yeah. be the next step, it really would have scared them. But there really wasn't the clue that was going to be the next step, you know, but they had definitely grown up and it was nice. And it also kind of let people know and let the establishment know that they weren't going anywhere.
Right.
And that, I think that question hung over their heads ever since the beginning, you know, because the establishment just frowned on them completely. And, you know, when they saw Rubber Soul and they saw the seriousness, they knew that wasn't going to happen. So
right. At that point, they were, I mean, they had proven themselves, if you will, or they were, well, you know, they were considered artists, really, from that point on. It's funny, we were talking before about the Grammy that Paul was, you know, involved with the song that was nominated for a Grammy. But in this year of, in 65, when they had all these singles that came out, mm-hmm. Including We Can Work It Out. They didn't win, like they were, I don't know, maybe think of it, but like Grammy completely snubbed them. It was their 11th number one single in less than 2 years. But even mm-hmm. with that, like they were, I think in that year, in 65, they were nominated for 11 Grammys and didn't win a single one. And Roger Miller's King of the Road, one, and over yesterday.
Right. Yeah, the Grammy history is just horrible.
Right.
It's embarrassing. It's really embarrassing.
I know. I think it's because they were threatened. You know, the American music industry just like was threatened by them and didn't really quite know what to make of them.
Well, plus also the Recording Academy was made up in those days, you know, of people whose musical background and whose musical head was basically stuck, you know, right in, you know, easy listening,
right,
big bands, you know, jazz, yeah, you know, anything but rock and roll.
Right. And isn't that why Frank Sinatra started Reprise Records as a way of, like, getting away from all of this and doing his, sort of taking over some of this for the old guard again?
Mm-hmm. But he ended up having to put rock and roll on Reprise to make money.
Right.
They weren't going to make money if they didn't.
He hated the Beatles. He hated them.
Well, he hated the Beatles, but then he ended up recording something, which...
Right. And yesterday as well.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, no, he hated rock and roll in general.
Well, and everything that it represented.
Yes. Yeah, very, very, very much so. So that's, you know, that kind of prevailing attitude is why the Beatles were constantly snubbed by, mm-hmm, you know, the Recording Academy, you know, but, you know, it's...
What I was going to say was that with Rubber Soul, also I think was when fans started getting this sense that there was more going on here. In other words, they started listening closely,
mm-hmm,
the close listening, and this sense that they had something important to say, that this was music and it was wonderful and we were being entertained and it was still danceable at that point. But beyond that, there was this sense that we were being communicated to.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's true. And there were also adult themes.
Yeah.
In a lot of those songs.
Right. It seemed more like man meets woman rather than boy meets girl.
Exactly.
You know, and the complexities of relationships. And this is where some, you know, young fans said, you know, like I got this, you know, sneak peek into this adult world that maybe I didn't really need or didn't fully understand. But Norwegian was actually a really good example of how fans of different ages reacted to that, because some of them thought, oh, this is just, like sleeping in the bathtub. That, you know, that struck some fans as funny and humorous. I didn't really get what was going on. Another one, you know, says like, well, I don't know, there was some kind of relationship that didn't end very well, you know, but older, like college age listeners said, oh, that song is about sexual freedom, and it's, you know, it just exudes freedom. And so whatever you brought to it, you know, the meaning you got out of it, you know, and this is this is kind of stuff that academics talk about, but you know, the meaning that you get is created in that space between what you bring and what the artist presents, you know. And so however, you know, if you were 10, 11, 12 or 20, that was going to determine how you interpreted this and the meaning that you got out of it. But because there was so much there, there's, you know, as it was such a rich stimulus, that there was a lot of meaning there. No matter what you brought to it, you could get something out of it. And that was true all along. And I think that's part of why we were so hooked in, because there was so much there to explore in terms of sound and meaning and just the feel, that how the music made you feel.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I've always thought that actually Rubber Soul was in some ways much more of a concept album than Pepper, because almost every one of the songs, with the possible exception of Nowhere Man, and you could probably bend it to the theme if you wanted to, these are all songs about love and its many different aspects, as Candy sort of hinted. You know, and yeah, all pop albums are almost all songs about love. But if you look at the, if you look at what's going on song by song, you know, the word is a different kind of love, right? It's, you know, love as a concept. Mm-hmm. And there is, you know, If I Needed Someone, which is, you know, just totally kind of casual, non-committal, like, oh, yeah, I might call you. Mm-hmm. drive my car is a kind of weird relationship where, you know, there's a relationship going on, but one person is a little subservient there, and it turns out to be the guy.
Now, you're talking about the UK. I was going to say that rubber soul.
Right. I was going to say that we all took the album home and put the needle down and heard a song that, from the Beatles' point of view, wasn't even on the album.
Exactly.
Right. Yeah. I mean, and actually, if you bring in the American ones, then you it still fits the theme. I've just seen a face. You know? In fact, actually, in a certain way, use the American one, then you don't have the problem of whether Nowhere Man fits the theme or not.
Yeah.
So, it's the American version is real. It's all love songs. And I think that was part of, I think that drew people in. I mean, I think that was part of it. In other words, I want to hold your hand, she loves, you know, all the other stuff were love songs too. Well, here's more, you know, he, she, boy, girl, whatever. But it's like, it was so, you know, more sophisticated, more grown up, more mature, more sexual on the surface, more sexual.
You've got Run for Your Life, which is, you know, sort of insane jealousy. I mean, not that you didn't have that already and you can't do that, but, you know, really every one of these songs takes a completely different look at love as a concept or as a motivator of relationships or whatever. And that to me makes this album hang together as sort of a song cycle, as they used to say back in Schubert's day, you know, more than Pepper is, you know, Pepper is a bunch of different things. And then, you know, we think of it as kind of a concept album, but we know it's not really a concept album. This is a concept album in a way. You know?
Yeah, I think that's true. I think that's definitely true. I mean, and so many different facets. And the word, I mean, I think is a really interesting song, because even if we say they're all love songs, it's sort of a slightly, like you said before, Allan, it's a slightly different kind of love song. But that's where the Beatles, John, but, you know, speaking for all of them, come out and say, like, you know, I'm here to show everybody the light. You know, this was a moment where I think that this is where they became, you know, the philosophers, if you will, the sages of our tribe. You know, this is where they kind of, you know, put consciously or unconsciously, you know, with tongue in cheek or high from whatever, but that's, you know, that's kind of what they put out there. And I'm here to show everybody the light and say the word and be like me. And it was very, very powerful, because again, looking at the context, what was going on in the country at that time with, you know, this is when we're already starting to hear all about the generation gap and, you know, Vietnam and all this, you know, it's really heating up at that point. And so they come out and really declare themselves, for all intents and purposes, the leaders of the counterculture.
It's almost as if it was All You Need Is Love, Mach 1.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. I think that's true.
Candy, where do you think the original, or I should say the youngest fans, how did they accept Rubber Soul? I mean, we know that the original fans who had been them with the from the beginning were fine with it, but I mean, did they start to grow up a little too quickly for some people, you think?
No, not with Rubber Soul. In terms of defecting and sort of keeping them not being so into it anymore. No, Rubber Soul did not turn off any young fans, because it was still accessible. It was still recognizable as music, you know, and it was beautiful. And it was also, the way it was recorded was very, you know, it was like they were singing right in your ear. You know, there was something, it was... some of them said I wasn't sure what to make of it. But again, by this point, there was this reservoir of trust between the Beatles and the fans. So even if you didn't get it right away, you know, they're singing about grown-up stuff, you know, but the songs were accessible. Now, of course, with Revolver, that changes, you know, with Tomorrow Never Knows and particularly Tomorrow Never Knows and Love You Too. In fact, the placement of Tomorrow Never Knows was especially disturbing, because it's like, this is what they left me with? Oh, no. The monkeys and all that, which, you know, as I've talked about before with Steve, and maybe some of you, you know, that the Monkees were there to fill that void when the Beatles started to become less accessible, let's say. But that didn't happen with Rubber Soul. And, you know, it may also be because they were all love songs. And they were, as brilliant and sophisticated and different as they were still accessible as love songs. Whereas with Revolver, that starts to be a little more out there and diverse theme. It was just a stranger thing. It was just less accessible, I think.
Right. She said was not a love song.
Right. Exactly. Well, it is, but who knows what it is, right? In other words, as a young fan, I mean, we know where it came from now, but again, like, nobody knew, like, we didn't know any of the backstories or the, you know, where these things came from, and sure. So... But Rubber Soul is very sweet and innocent in a way, if you think about it. It was really this wonderful moment where they really were blossoming. And of course, you know, we would be remiss to not point out that this was when they started really becoming full-blown potheads.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. True.
And, you know, in addition, I mean, I think at that point that was the drug of choice. And, you know, they say it one, you know, that's the pot album, and the others are the LSD album, you know, Revolver and Pepper. So I think that, and, you know, the 1965 book, Andrew Jackson's book, really is interesting in this regard because he focuses in on this one year. And, you know, we all know how important drugs were to the story of the evolution of the Beatles and all of this. But reading that book, you really see how this was the year where that really happened. And so, you know, one can reasonably ask, you know, what, you know, I mean, since everybody loves Beatle hypotheticals, let's throw one out. What if they weren't getting high? What would the album after help? That, you know, in other words, who knows? I mean, what did their expanded creativity, drug-induced, what did that give us, you know? Mm-hmm. It's interesting to think about.
That really is, actually. You know, when you consider that Dylan's most fruitful, well, okay, his first most fruitful period came... when at the point where he was really getting more and more involved with pot, you know, and also moving into electric, you know, moving into rock and roll and such. It's very interesting to think about where the Beatles' career and where their music would have gone if they had not had, say, some, shall we say, organic influence.
Right. Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, you could actually take that not only the Beatles, but all of this, you know, this pop music renaissance that we all experienced. I mean, it was really very much drug-fueled, you know. With them, you know, again, they were the leaders of every, you know, they were at the forefront of everything. But
sure.
Yeah, I know the history, I know the story, but it was interesting reading the book that, you know, Andrew's book that really just drills down on 1965. Yes. And you really see this very,
very much so.
Clearly.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So, I mean, did fans know listening to Rubber Soul that they were, I don't think we knew that for the most part.
We didn't know. We didn't know any of that. In fact, a lot of us didn't even know at that point what pot was.
Right.
I think it was really not until, Paul's interview after the week or so after Pepper came out.
Yes,
it was exactly. Obvious. But I mean, some fans looked at Sgt., even not the Lucy thing aside. I think that by that point, older fans, there were some that were sophisticated enough to realize what was going on with that. But most fans had no idea.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Kenny, did you interview people? I'm sure you did, actually, who were, say, in college around the time this came out. Because I mean, we were.
Yes, I did. Yeah, I did. In fact, I had one person I interviewed. This woman, she went to see Help, and she herself was already a pot smoker. Mm-hmm. And so, remembers it in that way. So I think that some older fans were more kind of aware of some of those things. I mean, are you asking me about the drug aspect or just being older in general?
I wonder if they, I mean, I guess the sort of information coming out about what the Beatles themselves were up to was kind of limited in terms of, you know, drugs and things like that. But I'm just sort of wondering whether older people could intuit, you know, that something was going on.
Yeah, I think some older, as I said before, even with Rubber Soul, I mean, I think some older fans might have had, you know, might have had that sense. I didn't ask about that particular Rubber Soul, but I remember this one woman saying about Help that, not necessarily that she knew the Beatles were, but in other words, I guess what I'm saying is that you had older fans, college age, who themselves were, because that was the moment where that was all happening. I mean, that's the thing about 65, is that's when pop became not only for jazz musicians and beatniks and whoever, mm-hmm. you know, it really became somewhat mainstream in 65, you know, certainly on a college campus. So, yeah, I mean, some fans were sophisticated in that way and experienced it in the way the Beatles produced it, let's say. Mm-hmm. But for most of us, we had no idea. And then there were some fans who said that even after Pepper, they didn't want to believe that the Beatles were using drugs. They didn't. Mm-hmm. It ruined their perception of them, you know. Yeah. And especially, and also too, with there was when in the summer of 67, when that all came out about with Paul and all that, his interview, and then parents got very concerned. You know, it's one thing to emulate their hair and form a band, but I don't want you doing this. And then we started hearing all the stuff about chromosome damage from LSD and all these things. And a couple of fans said, well, I don't know how to reconcile this, because people are telling me, on the one hand, I'm being told this is dangerous, stay away from this, is very bad. But here are these guys who are doing this, and they're creating this great art. And yeah, I mean, I talk about the drugs, and it's funny because I didn't really know we were going to get into this, but I think it's an interesting part of the story. You know, again, like my approach to the Beatles is, you know, I look very much at the context and the experience of growing up with them. And it's this, the whole drug thing is an aspect of this that really doesn't get talked about enough. But it was, you know, there's no question that they certainly inspired unwittingly a lot of people to use drugs. It's just a fact. So now, whether that started with Rubber Soul, probably not. But certainly, the album itself, they were indulging at that time, which does not take away from it. I mean, you know, I mean, if people through the ages have used all kinds of hallucinogenics and you know, drugs to write and do art, so it's that per se is not really unique to them. I think what makes it's a different kind of question because of the cultural role that they took on as leader, you know, as role model in that huge demographic. So their substance use kind of becomes, it's a different thing.
Yeah.
It's true. Actually, one thing, though, it should, you know, kind of a disclaimer on that is that, you know, there were some people who were, you know, around my age, and I was about 16 at that point, and, you know, not everybody slavishly followed everything that the Beatles did.
Right.
You know,
that's
true. You know, so there were people who were major fans, but they weren't silly enough to say, oh, well, I have to do everything that John Lennon does.
Right. Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, they were, yeah, I mean, that's true. Not everybody went along with everything they did. And you know, it was sort of a contagion, I think. You know, if you think about how we, you know, we listened with friends, we listened in mixed age groups, you know, so there was some older kid who knew something, and, you know, so maybe that was the older kid who was going to bring the pot first or whatever. So it's so there was, you know, I mean, it was, but you're right. I mean, not everybody went along with everything that they did, and but they were a focal point. And even if you didn't go along with it, you knew what they were up to, and you probably knew some people who were going along with it.
Very true.
And I don't think the drug thing had really permeated the culture just yet, because I mean the top
in 65.
No, the top movie, the most popular movie in 65 was Sound of Music. So I mean,
that's true.
Yeah, no, people were still, you know, kind of adrift. I should say, hadn't caught on to that yet, you know, so.
Yeah, most people had not by 60, but definitely not. But, you know, absolutely by the time of Pepper, I mean, there was already, you see the influence in advertising. I mean, you can look at advertising, you know, around that period and almost tell, like, is this, well, even back in 64, you can say, is this pre-Beatles or post-Beatles? And same thing with the psychedelic period. I mean, it changed everything. I mean, it's the, I shouldn't say it changed everything, because that's really kind of, in a sense, a meaningless phrase. But you start to see in advertising and fashion and interior design, you know, you start to see this psychedelicized.
Right. True.
You know, and even like, and it got into other, you know, like other, what is it, Reflections by the Supremes. I mean, you start to see this kind of, you know, this, and, you know, in TV, you know, this kind of sort of slightly diluted, you know, whitewashed sort of way of incorporating this new aesthetic into different forms and things. It was really a fascinating time, you know. Every time I start talking about it with people who are, you know, equally as enamored of the period and the Beatles, I mean, it's fascinating, because it was we were really blessed and really lucky to live at that time and experience this. I write about this, and I talk about it, and I sort of forget about it, and then I'm in a conversation like this, and it really kind of hits me anew, you know, that it really was quite an amazing thing that we, and it was only 6 years, and it was done, you know, and then we have all this music to listen to. But yeah, do you think people will be listening to Rubber Soul in 50 years?
No question. No question.
Yeah, I think so too.
No question. It's, you know, and having a musicologist here, I can, you know, kind of assume that he'll back me up on this. But I, you know, to a great extent, the Beatles have become the, in a sense, the classical music of this time, of this age.
Probably. I mean, that's one way of. I mean, there are different kinds of classical music now. There's a million different kinds of, but you know, I mean, one thing that I think we're seeing, and I haven't seen it much with Rubber Soul, although I wouldn't be surprised if there was one out there, but we're beginning to see people covering whole albums. There are, I can think of two or three recordings of Sgt. Pepper people have done. It started with Big Daddy years ago and did it as a kind of 50s thing. And
which was not very good. I'm sorry. I didn't.
It was amusing. There's one that I don't know if it was released or not, but someone sent me files for it, which is a chamber ensemble basically called Art of Time. But they
I haven't heard that one.
Yeah, they also use it's not just straight chamber instruments. There's band stuff and everything in it, but they just did a full Pepper, and they've been touring with it.
And of course there's the Cheap Trick version and the which is really, really good. And the I can't remember. I should remember his name, because he put me. He credited me on the album. The guitarist Andy. Can't remember his name now.
Is it Timmons? Or something?
Yes. Yeah. Which is very, very good.
It is. And then there's the Smithereens doing Meet the Beatles. So I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if, you know, as this trend picks up, that we start seeing people reinterpreting not just Beatles songs but whole Beatles albums. And Rubber Soul, I think, holds a lot of promise for that kind of thing. But you know, we talked a little bit before about the difference of the British and American Rubber Soul, but Rubber Soul also has a number of stereo and mono differences, you know, the full start on I'm Looking Through You. And so Rubber Soul is, you know, as fanatical collector, if any of you regard yourselves as that. I mean, it's an album that you were able to discover several times in different ways.
You know, actually, and I was going to bring up the discussion about whether the American version is better than the UK version. And there are a number of people, and not just, I don't know if it's just U.S. fans or not, but I mean, a number of people think the American Rubber Soul is better than the UK.
Well, I think for the reason that Allan said, it's more cohesive.
It hangs together, and as you said, as we were saying before, they're all love songs. They're all kind of within the same themes. Whereas the UK one is more diverse. It has more outliers in that sense. They're both great. I think it's like pizza. I think you like the one you grew up with. Yeah.
I like that analogy. That's a great analogy. Yeah.
And in that vein, a lot of, there are a lot of young people who perhaps got into the Beatles in the late 80s when the first CDs came out and when Apple basically made the UK versions, the uniform versions of the catalog. And so they don't know any other versions of those albums, but the UK versions. It's only the people who are, from the earlier Beatle generations or music generations that know the American albums. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So it's probably very much that if you kind of grew up with the lineup from the American album, that's the one you kind of gravitate to. If not, if you grew up, say, anywhere from the mid-80s on or earlier mid-80s on, it's probably the UK lineup.
Mm-hmm. Do you think that's so still the case for those of us like our age where, we have had now the UK ones on CD for quite a long time? And I think a lot of us also got into the UK ones as LPs way back once we discovered there are differences.
Yes.
Do you still gravitate to the American one?
I do. Mm. I admit it.
So if you put one on, it's going to be the U.S. one?
I have them listed. I have American Rubber Soul, American Revolver. That's how I have them in my – that's how I categorize. Although Revolver, I'm coming around. I think I like the British Revolver now. But, I think it gets into your – it's when it got into your DNA, what was the configuration, And I think that – knowing that it's not an accurate representation of their artistic development and knowing, all that we do now about how these other records came to be, it's Beatle music, I love Yesterday and Today, which is, of course, the bastard child that, was created in this melange, I love that. I just think it's a great collection of songs. Is it a legitimate album? Well, maybe not, it depends how one wants to define that, but it also, I think, gets to how we enjoy music and what I don't know. I love Yesterday and Today, and I'm not ashamed to admit it.
I think though that with the UK albums on CD for so long, I think it's probably the U.S. album thing has kind of mellowed a little bit, or I should say weakened a little bit. I don't think it's as strong as it used to be.
Well, of course, now what you can do, all you have to do is go into iTunes.
Exactly. You make a
playlist of all of the 14 songs from the UK Rubber Soul. Add in I've Just Seen a Face and It's Only Love, and you've got the perfect Rubber Soul.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah, you can. Yeah, I mean, that's the other thing. You raise a really important point about, we're talking about how people listen and will people be listening in the future. I mean, the whole notion of an album has changed since music has become digital. And so it's about songs now more than it is about albums, I think, to a large extent.
Right.
But when I was writing the book, I was I put together Yesterday and Today, I made my little playlist of Yesterday and Today, and I hadn't listened to that collection in one sitting like that in quite a while, and I loved it. It was really, again, recognizing that it's this Frankenstein of an album, It was great. It's the Beatles.
I know we've discussed this here before, but with the U.S. albums box set that basically took the remasters and shuffled them all around, the earlier Capitol albums box sets, are those more in tune do you like those more than the U.S. album set, or do you take the U.S. album set as a, you know, as for what it is, as a modernization of the catalog?
I don't know. I mean, I don't know. I'll let someone else answer that. I think, you know, I mean, as unsophisticated and as, you know, retro as it sounds, I really do think it's like pizza. Mm-hmm. And you, because it does, I mean, you when a song ends, it's so ingrained in you, you expect to hear the next one. I don't know. It's an interesting thing. I mean, this whole difference between the UK and the American is yet another aspect of them. Mm-hmm. That is, you know, that is engaging and opens our minds to things, you know.
We're back.
Another interesting thing about the American Rubber Soul is that it's only 30 minutes long. Mm-hmm. Right? And I think that this, You know, you listen to it, it's only a half, and you fans played it over and over and over again. And they talked about, you know, it was so satisfying that they just got up and put it on again. And, you know, they remember, you know, memorizing it in the weekend, you know, or just sitting in their room and listening to it over and over, because it's quick. You know, it's very quick.
Mm-hmm. Well, they all sort of were in those days, especially the American ones, because, you know, we only got 12 tracks instead of 14.
Right. That's right.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. So. But
there was this desire to, like, get to know it, you know, to know the words and to drive to familiarize yourself with it right away. And it was also, you know, so you'd listen by yourself, then you would listen with your friends and discuss it. And it was, you know, it was a very communal experience.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, in terms of getting to know the words, like from an American perspective, you know, and some things were very weird, like, you know, and you won't see me, when I call you up, your line's engaged. I had a really hard time figuring out what that line was, because we don't talk about lines being engaged. We just say busy.
Right. I know.
So, I know.
We were so tuned. I mean, it was like this quaint, you know, this, like, another cool thing. It was this British expression.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we were all besotted with that kind of stuff, you know.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, definitely. And to kind of answer what Steve was saying before, or asking before, about the, you know, the original American mix of Rubber Soul as opposed to the version of Rubber Soul that was put in the U.S. albums box last year. I think Candy's right. I think it's like pizza. It's, you know, if there's a particular, you know, a particular type of pizza that you kind of grew up with, that's what you like. Mm-hmm. So it's the same kind of thing here, that if the original American mix of Rubber Soul is what you grew up with, that's what you like. If you grew up, again, as I was saying before, with the, you know, the UK lineup and the UK mix, say, from the original CDs of 1987, you know, that's what you prefer.
And technically speaking, that original mix, the Dave Dexter mix, is, I mean, that's, those things are horrible. I mean, but that's what we had, you know, back then.
And
I don't remember River Soul being that affected by it, do you?
It's not as affected by it as Beatles' earlier second album and something new and those albums.
Yeah,
but they still didn't have the better quality mixes that the UK ones did. So, but yeah, it wasn't nearly as bad.
Mm-hmm.
So now that we've had remixes for the one stuff, how do you guys feel about a remixed Rubber Soul completely from scratch?
Sure, I have no problem, because I had no problem with the 87 remix of Help and Rubber Soul. I found it more listenable so that it wouldn't have, again, you know, that great contrast of everything in one channel, all the instruments in one channel, all the vocals all the way over on the other side, you know, that kind of thing, that it was more moderate and more listenable.
I would love it, but I would dread if they would redo everything and put it all out. Just the expense of, you know, people having to buy everything.
Well, yeah.
No one makes you buy it.
But you know how it. I mean, we all know how it is.
Yeah.
And you know, people are gonna be wanting that stuff, especially because the one mixes were so good. I mean, it's actually really kind of amazing. I mean, I don't know what you've encountered, Allan. I know Al probably has, and I have. I mean, the reaction to the one mixes has been incredibly positive. Way more positive than you'd ever expect from Beatle fans. I mean, because Beatle fans are so critical. I mean, they really are. And I'm not saying that in a kind of a snarky way. I mean, it's just the truth. You know, yeah. I mean, I admit I have not seen some of the. I'm sure that there are people that have gone through these things and gone into great detail. And I have not had the chance to really look at that. I know one person that did do it, but you know, I mean, even that, you know, there has been an incredibly positive response, and it's just really, really amazing.
It's interesting to think, you know, I mean, down the road, there's going to be other formats probably that maybe can't even envision, and how many times we've purchased these songs.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not over yet, I don't think.
Blu-ray's been rumored for a couple of years now. So that's one thing that, you know, that and people keep mentioning they'd like to see it on see them on Blu-ray, and so that's I'm not talking like the Blu-ray on the video videos. I'm talking about Blu-ray audio.
So
there's something right there, you know. God only you're right. We don't even know what hasn't been invented yet. So
sure, and think of, as Candy was saying, the number of formats that we have bought this album in 50 years, you know, from LPs to cassettes to 8-tracks to, you know, and some people who bought pre-recorded reel-to-reels in those days,
right.
Mm-hmm. You know, to CDs, to
stereo and mono.
Stereo, you're right, mm-hmm. Stereo and mono.
British and American.
Right. Exactly. And then, and of course, the Japanese versions that were, you know, that were back in the 80s were considered to be so much better, you know, and on and on and on. And, you know, think of how many.
Yeah, maybe Apple should, if we, you know, send them listings of our collections, give us one upgrade free.
Right. That's a good idea.
You know, really?
You know, to go off topic for a second, I bought the 18-disc Dylan 1965-66 set.
You lucky dog, you.
Well, and it wasn't cheap, but, you know, I love that stuff, and I felt I should have it, even though I actually already had most of it on bootlegs. But this is a beautiful production. And on Friday, the people who had bought the set got an email from Sony saying, "We are giving you, as a bonus, 208 more tracks."
Yes. Yeah, I heard that today. I heard that today.
The live stuff, basically, from 65. Now, some of it is audience recordings. A lot of it is soundboard, a couple of TV show performances. I mean, it's just incredible. And in terms of fostering goodwill towards a company, that's the way to do it.
That's the way to do it. Wow. Yeah.
Wow. That's interesting.
Yeah, I heard about this from Tom Frangione as well.
I got the email from Dylan.com today, and I immediately looked at the price. I was going, well, if it's a decent price, I might have to run in and do it. And then I looked at the price, and I went, I'm going to have to think about this one.
Yeah.
This is not cheap. Not even close to cheap.
No, not even. That's not on my landscape.
Yeah. You lucky dog, you.
But if you consider you're getting another 14 discs worth, you know.
You have to download those 14 discs, though, do you not?
Yeah, and they're available only on MP3s at 320. So it's, you know, it's okay. But yeah, I mean, it's, I don't know. I just thought it was a, I'd heard that it was coming actually, but until it actually turned up, I wasn't sure whether to believe it. And I thought, well, you know, why doesn't Apple do something like this? You know, and we'd be happy to buy, you know, the 18 discs of, you know, whatever it is, and you know, and then have a bonus as well. I mean, that's, it's really nice.
How about
bootlegs? But anyway, that's a digression.
How about Beatles bootlegs recordings 1965? I mean, that, there we go.
Yeah, they're not going to do it.
No, I know they're not. I know they're not. But
so, yeah.
Speaking of availability of Beatles music, have the Beatles been completely removed from YouTube?
I don't think so.
They seem to be getting there because, you know, when I've been, you know, the stuff that I do online, the kind of anniversaries and and things, when I've been looking for certain Beatles recordings recently, I've noticed that
they're not there anymore.
Yeah, so it's very because when the Rubber Soul anniversary came up, I'm looking for, you know, any, basically almost any track from the album. And I'm getting, you know, this cover and this cover.
Exactly,
and this
exactly,
cover,
yeah. You know, I'm wondering if it had, I mean, because it must have been pretty recently, because I mean, I rely on them a lot for different things. So
yes.
A quick way to, you know, and there was this sort of, almost every song was there, and they looked like, I don't know if they were official Apple postings, but they looked legit, you know?
Yeah.
And suddenly that whole, they're all not there anymore. So
yeah.
I'm thinking they got rid of them. And it seems to have coincided with the release of one, although that may just be a coincidence.
It's very possible.
Mm-hmm. I don't know, a few weeks ago when I wrote Andy White's obit for the Times, they, you know, they like having links, and so I put in links to both Love Me Do's, and they were both pretty easy to find, and while I was looking for those, the whole Please Please Me album came up, and so as of a couple of weeks ago, those tracks were still there.
Yeah.
Well, as of last week, I don't know, because I looked for a few things, and they, I don't know.
Mm. Interesting. Well, the more they take them down, the more people are going to put them up again. So you just have to catch them when you can, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, I'm seeing, you know, I'm still seeing stuff uploaded every day. So it's not like it's not happening.
And I suppose maybe we should mention one other news item, which is that the videos for One and One Plus, I think, went up on iTunes today.
Right.
Mm-hmm. If you want to get those things in that format, there.
Those are really a treat. Those are an absolute treat.
Mm-hmm.
They really are.
Yep.
Which again may account for what Candy was just saying about the sudden disappearance of much of the you know, the core catalog.
Right.
Yeah, I somehow think it's related, but I could be completely wrong. I don't know. But I mean, Alan's saying he found stuff. You know, he found Love Me Do a few weeks ago. So I don't know. But
yeah.
So this has been a fun discussion of a fascinating album, a really important album in the Beatles catalog. And on behalf of all of us, I'd like to thank Candy for turning up and talking to us. And when is the paperback version of Beatleness coming out?
That was actually a kind of a secret, but it's going to be coming out in time for the fest.
In April.
I see.
So it will not be out for holiday gift giving. So everybody who wants to buy Beatleness as a gift for somebody this holiday season, which they absolutely should, because any Beatle fan will love it, you'll have to buy the paperback. But the hardcover, excuse me, but the paperback will be out in the spring.
There is also an audio version, isn't there?
Yes, there is, and it's also an ebook. So whatever format you
there
like.
There you go.
Mm-hmm. Just like the Beatles, whatever format it's available.
There you go. Yeah.
It's like pizza.
Pizza.
I like the hardback.
somebody asked me was I working on another book and what was it going to be then? And I jokingly said, I think I'm going to write a book about pizza because I want to only write about things that everybody loves.
Al, you have anything you want to mention coming up that you're doing? You might as well mention your book anyway.
Yes, absolutely. For those of you who are looking for something historical to give to somebody for Christmas, by all means, Change in Times, 101 Days that Shaped a Generation, covering the period from November 22nd, 1963 to March 1st, 1964, on Parading Press. I think you'll really enjoy it, especially if you're going to give it to some very history-minded young person, or even an old codger who remembers that period.
It's a great book. And I enjoyed reading it a lot.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. And Steve, what should fans of yours give to their?
I have a very cheap gift for any, especially Monkees fans. I have a book called Meet a Monkey, Davy Jones. It's on Kindle and you can get it on Nook. It's only 99 cents. It's very cheap. And it has the contents of my interviews with Davy Jones. And he does talk about the Beatles, so it's Beatle related also. So there you go.
Okay. And everyone should feel free to pick up multiple copies of my book, The Beatles from the Cavern to the Rooftop, Fiden Press. Or I think the ebook of Got That Something, How the Beatles, I Want to Hold Your Hand, Changed Everything is still out there. But then you can think of Candy saying that how things change everything doesn't mean anything. But that's okay. you can read the book and you can decide whether that changed everything. And
there we go.
Send Candy a note.
It did change everything. But sometimes in conversation, when you say that, it sounds like hyperbole. But when you're talking about the Beatles, there's really no such thing as hyperbole, you know, because it was so dramatic an impact.
That's true. That, now I feel better.
All right.
Okay. I don't think I came up with that title, actually, though. So anyway, so for my co-hosts, Steve Marinucci and Al Sussman, and in absentia, Ken Michaels, and for our guest, Candy Leonard, this is Alan Kozin saying goodbye and see you next time.